For many, the idea of liquidity pool on decentralized exchanges is hard to understand, though there is no need for that. In today's episode, we will discuss everything you need to know about liquidity pools, how to manage them, and all the associated risks. Hi, I'm Vlad, and here is your BunnyMoney channel, where we discuss all things crypto trading and finance. I would like to remind you that this channel is made for educational purposes only and does not contain any financial advice. So learn and have fun. If you clicked on this video, I assume that you already have some knowledge about decentralized crypto trading protocols like Uniswap, SushiSwap, or PancakeSwap, or that you at least have heard of them. And while there are several of decentralized exchanges with liquidity pools, most of them are just forks of the initial Uniswap exchanges. Sure, some features may vary, but the core principle and the product design are almost the same. And this is a good thing because if you understand how one of them works, you are unlikely to encounter problems when using another one. After you create your token, you would need to create a liquidity pool on one of these DEXs. So let's start by talking about liquidity pools and their basics. Liquidity pools are one of the core concepts behind DeFi ecosystem. They are collections of funds, or as we call them, tokens, locked in smart contracts. They are used to facilitate decentralized trading, lending, and other features by providing liquidity indexes. Traditional centralized exchanges like Coinbase, Binance, KuCoin have their trading logic based on an order book model, which allows people who would like to buy assets and those who would like to sell them to come together and place their orders. The main goal for buyers is to find the lowest price and for the sellers to find the highest price. If there are buyers who start bidding higher or sellers who set a price lower than the average, a match will be found and the trade will happen. In case the existing price don't satisfy any of the sides, market makers will be involved. Market makers are individual participants or members of the exchange who buy and sell assets. They provide liquidity for the market by profiting from the difference in the bid-ask spread. They always agree to buy or sell an asset for a specific price, which is why the users of an exchange can trade at all times with no waiting period. The disadvantage of this order book model is that it relies on market makers, who really make the market and without whom it will be really difficult to facilitate trades. This dependence created the need for something new, which is how we have liquidity pools on decentralized crypto exchanges. A liquidity pool might have two tokens or a particular pair and be considered a market for this pair. For example, we might have an ETH and USDT liquidity pool. In case a pool is generated, the first provider sets an initial price of the assets in it. When creating such pool, the provider supplies the two assets, making sure their value is the same. If the price of one of them differs from the price for the same asset elsewhere, this creates an arbitrage opportunity, which in turn creates a possibility of a liquidity provider to lose money. If others choose to add more tokens into the liquidity pool, they would have to make sure they supply both tokens that this liquidity pool has. Every liquidity provider receives a certain amount of LP tokens, which is proportionate to how much liquidity is supplied. In other words, when people use a pool to exchange tokens, they pay a fee that goes to the liquidity provider. Depending on how many liquidity providers are out there, this fee will be divided between them. In case those liquidity providers would like to get their money back from the pool and keep their earnings, they must burn their LP tokens. If you really simplify it, you can imagine it as if you used a centralized exchange, you would pay a transaction fee to the exchange. But since you are using a decentralized one, you pay it to the liquidity providers instead. When you buy a token through the pool, there are no sellers on the other side. Your activity is managed by the algorithm that governs what happens in the liquidity pool. Each time a new swap is made in the pool, the price adjusts for the particular pair. This is what's called an automated market maker. For example, the most commonly used market maker algorithm's formula is X multiplied by Y equals K. Here, X and Y represent the quantity of each token in the pool. K is the fixed constant that keeps the total liquidity of the pool the same. X is the number of tokens for asset A, Y is the number of tokens for asset B. For example, if you have 10 ETH and 10,000 of DAI, it would be a pool of 100,000. After someone buys ETH from this pool, the quantity of ETH will decrease, while the quantity of DAI will increase. For example, if we buy 2 ETH, we can calculate the quantity of DAI in the pool after this transaction the following way. We can also calculate how much DAI needs to be paid to obtain those 2 ETH. Let's change it up again and say that we would like to buy 5 ETH instead of 2. The calculations would look like that. As we can see, no matter how many trades happen, there is always liquidity. The formula increases the price of the token in relation to demand. Another important factor is the ratio of tokens in the pool that dictates the price. The bigger the pool, the less the impact on the price. This means that a larger pool allows space for bigger trades without influencing the price too much. There are following types of risks associated with current liquidity pools. These are impermanent loss, hacks, and bugs. Impermanent loss refers to the process of decreasing value that happens once you take your tokens out of the pool. Compared to you just holding the asset, sometimes the value of what you get might be less than if you simply kept it and not put it into the liquidity pool. However, keep in mind that once you decide to take your tokens out of the liquidity pool, you also earn fees that those who made transactions paid. These fees might compensate for the lost value of your token or sometimes even overcompensate. In other words, the impermanent loss happens when the price of your token changes compared to when deposited in the pool. The larger such change, the bigger the loss. This means that the token has less dollar value at the time of withdrawal than at the time of deposit. This change happens regardless of the direction the price goes. The possibility of an impermanent loss depends on the volatility of the tokens. The more volatile, the higher the probability the impermanent loss will happen. If you would like to calculate it, you can use this tool. It will tell you the value you will have by holding onto the assets and the value you will have by providing the liquidity. Other two risks, which are hacks and bugs, are on a more technical side of things. As anything, liquidity pools are prone to hacks and sabotage, which is why before jumping into any of them, check their security and history. After you created your token, anyone who has it can create a liquidity pool on DEX platform. If you have 100% of the total supply, you would be able to provide this liquidity. When you do so, you are the first to set up the initial price of your token. By creating a pool, you need to decide how much liquidity to provide for your token. For that, you would need to know what the initial market cap of your project should be. Let's say you created a DAI token and you would like for its market cap to be $100,000. Your total supply is $100,000. You choose to create a pool with your DAI token and USDT. You decide to put 10,000 of DAI and 10,000 of USDT into this pool. This means that you only provided a 10% supply of your token while keeping 90% in your hands. Most people would view this as risky, since you have an opportunity to drive the price however you want with this 90%. To avoid that and gain trust, it's wiser to put in a bigger percentage into the liquidity pool. Liquidity pools are one of the advantages of DeFi, which we discussed in our previous video. DeFi has a tremendous potential to grow into something big in the future. However, as with any crypto project, you need to be careful. Stay cautious and always try to have as much information as possible. This was our episode for today. If you found it useful, please consider subscribing. This is your BunnyMoney channel. I'm Vlad. See you in the next episode.